Well, we'll do a little tag team today, so I'll do half, and then Elizabeth will come up. And but it's a real privilege to be able to be with you and share with you. And we really are very hopeful in these times. We are excited. The Lord did send us a couple of years ago to California, and He said, where He spoke, He said, the state has been discounted, it's been misunderstood, it's been prophesied into the sea, and all kinds of things. And He said, but My Holy Spirit is hovering over that state, and its greatest days are ahead of it. And I want you to go proclaim that, walk beside people who believe that, and begin to speak how He was going to invade every area of society here in California, change everything. And He reminded me, what He told me, He says, it's still the forerunner state. It has been for over 100 years. And the things that take place here in California don't just influence America, but they end up influencing the whole world. You know, all the spiritual revivals, the moves of the Holy Spirit of the last 100-plus years have all really originated in California and then gone global. That would be as it relates to using my paradigm of the seven mountains. That would be the mountain of religion activity. But even the activity, the mountain of economy or business, Silicon Valley, you have it near here, and whatever begins here goes worldwide as well. And really, mountain by mountain, the Lord began to show me how California is poised and positioned to be a lead domino for everything that takes place around the world. And so I believe He is about to release, I think He already has some measure of it, but there's going to be a more obvious release, one that will be reported on of His presence. We'll call it, you know, it's going to be different. It's revival. A lot of people are calling for revival, but it's revival plus the Lord touching every area of society, which goes into reformation. So I believe we want an atmosphere of revival, but the assignment is reformation, where He manifests Himself as the God of cities and nation. So I kind of contend for some, I haven't found the right word to make up. I go reviver-mation or something, but not just revival, not just reformation, but both. Anyway, I want to share a few minutes just about how many of you have never heard of the terminology seven mountains, have no idea what that is, if you can raise your hand. Okay. I just want to explain some of that for you. It was already done well briefly there, but it really is, it's an invitation to believe a macro narrative that God has for us. When He began to share it with me, kind of by revelation, and I had a dream, encounters with the Lord, it was like getting a shoehorn stuck inside of my mind and expanding my perspectives, because I realized I grew up thinking that what God was interested in was limited to only souls, and that, you know, then as we understood more and more the kingdom, well, He wants souls, but He wants souls to be also filled with the Holy Spirit. And then I believed in the God of salvation and a God who could speak prophetically as well. And we saw all those things. The Seven Mountain Mandate is an understanding of a greater God, of a God who has solutions for every area of society. And the seven, I'm just going to tell you couple of things here. We have resources. We don't have too many resources, but we'll have them on the table. Then they'll speak into all these things. I really won't tell you, I'll just barely hit upon some of the things that we have available. But the seven mountains are seven primary spheres of society, spheres of culture. And in no particular order, they would be media, government, education, economy or business, arts and entertainment. We call it the mountain of celebration of arts and entertainment, the mountain of family, and the mountain of religion or the mountain of worship, which is where the church gathers, and this would be an activity that's taking place on the mountain of religion. So it's an understanding that we do not only have an assignment on the mountain of religion. Our assignment is not just to get people saved, but we have an assignment, a responsibility, and a privilege to receive the kingdom of God and impact every area of society, starting with these seven primary areas of society. That we have a call not just to get people saved in government. It's not just about getting people saved in education and government and arts and entertainment. But that the systems themselves don't operate correctly. They're not functioning the way they're supposed to. And so there is God's better way of doing things. To add real language to what the kingdom of God is. We don't want it to be just too ethereal. the end of the day, the kingdom of God translates into the best outcomes here on earth as well. So the kingdom of God, the kingdom way, is the better way of doing things. And it even gets recognized by men on earth. When Joseph received the solution for the famine that was coming to Egypt and declared it, even Pharaoh goes, "Oh my, that'll work. The Spirit of the living God is on this guy." So the kingdom of God doesn't just come in like the world doesn't get it. The kingdom of God comes and they go, "Oh wow, we just got something that translates into better outcomes." So God has better outcomes in education, in economy, arts and entertainment, family, media, etc., in every area of society. And this is what we have, again, resources and books. And again, if we don't have too much here, I'll just throw it out. You can look at johnnyandelizabeth.com, and we have resource pages, and we have all our materials available on audible.com, and we also have them. Is it audible.com? Well, how do they do that? You should be telling this later on. I just happen, you know, I'm only the two of the book are in Audible, but they're downloadable as well. We have downloadable forms, books. Okay, ebooks and audiobooks. So whatever we don't have here, and I recommend them because they really expand your perspective on who God is. A.W. Tozer, I'm always quoting him. He says, "What you think about God is the most important thing about you." So if you change your perspective on who he is, it changes who you are, changes your outcomes. It changes how much of the kingdom you're able to manifest through you. If you think of him as a limited God who's just trying to get some people saved, and he really doesn't know what to do with this messed up world, and he's just finally at the end of the day going to have to come with some blow torches and blow everything up, rescue us out of here, and then he's going to be nice to us in the future, then you have a limited perspective of God. You believe in the God of the hereafter. And you're sure he's going to be a great Santa Claus for us and just spoil us rotten in the end. But he is available for much more than that. He's still Emmanuel, God with us. And he has the solutions that this world needs in every area of society. I won't have time to go into testimonials, but we have really amazing testimonies of what God is doing in government, in economies, in Hollywood, in so many areas of society, as sons and daughters of the king are willing to carry his presence there. So the seven mountains, just say it another way, it's an understanding of our assignment beyond souls. It's an understanding of the gospel of the kingdom, which is beyond just the gospel of salvation. Understanding that it's about souls, that God wants to save people, is an understanding of the gospel of salvation, but we want to understand him as the God of the gospel of the kingdom. When Jesus taught us to pray, the Lord's Prayer, in the first message of Jesus, he says, when you pray, pray this way: Father which art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Kingdom come, not let them escape to heaven. Your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And that was his first message to us. In his first message, he said, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the earth. You change things here. And he was looking for those who would partner with him to receive the kingdom on earth. And on earth as it is in heaven is a huge challenge. You can chew on that. I chewed on that for months. It really can challenge you. It didn't say on earth, you know, a taste of what's in heaven. But as it is, that's a high level. And if you consider what's taking place in heaven, they're not crusades. They don't have evangelistic crusades in heaven. You know, Papa God doesn't stop things at 6 p.m. and say, hey, every head bowed, want to give opportunity for people to come to Jesus. They already know Jesus in heaven. So when he says on earth as it is in heaven, he's talking about something beyond salvation. He's talking about the way heaven functions. So these seven areas of society, the seven mountains, are seven functions of heaven that we are to receive and manifest here on the earth. I've talked about the mountain of government. See, there is government in heaven. Don't know if you know that. Hope that doesn't mess you all up if you're anti-government. Because he doesn't abdicate his throne when we go to heaven. He still runs things. But there is a glory to a properly executed government. And he executes government perfectly. He's servant-hearted. He keeps it just. It's safe for everyone. And so everyone loves it. And so he invites us. When Jesus said, on earth as it is in heaven, he was in essence saying, Papa, the way government functions in heaven, let it come function on earth. Same way, we can go to another mountain, the mountain of arts and entertainment. The celebration of arts and entertainment is where we see him as creator. We're invited to see him as the creative one. And this is where we've missed out. We haven't seen him in this capacity, but our God is a compulsive creative. And he's not just creator and creative. He's a compulsive creative. It says, in his presence is fullness of joy. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore. It doesn't say, you know, in his presence is like a little acerbic humor plus some serious things because we are in serious days. No. Fullness of joy. And we understand even when the Holy Spirit showed up in Acts 2 with fullness of joy, everybody thought everybody was drunk. So these people are not drunk as you suppose. Why do they suppose? Because they were acting like drunk people. Too much presence. So if you don't like that stuff, stay away from the throne room when you go to heaven. Stay out and go to paradise. Stay with the trees, the fruit trees, something else. Do not get near the throne because there's like more joy than you can handle. But we are invited to see him in this creative way. You know, in the beginning, in Genesis 1, he is introduced to us as creator. In the beginning, God created. And then he goes into overdrive with his creativity. He begins to make mountains and rivers and trees, and he does them in every kind of shape. You know, the trees, he didn't just like create a cool oak tree and go, hey, I like that, 1 billion. There's oak and redwood. It's like every conceivable kind of tree you can think of. There's fat ones, thick ones, tall ones, a lot of branches, little branches. And he gets done, he's like, you know, I'd like to put some fruit on some of these. And he's throwing some fruit, like some orange ones there, yellow ones there, green, purple, and he's just flinging paint all over the place. He's introduced to us as creator. Then he goes on, he gets to the animals. I just, you know, what was he thinking with the animals? You know, the elephant, the long thing. You got the giraffe with the long neck. And then the monkeys and then the zebras and the unicorns and, like, alligators. Like, my goodness. I mean, he's just in overdrive with just creativity. You know, he didn't, like, say, okay, Labradors, they'll make really good friends for humans. Let's have 1 million of them. Oh, even in the dogs, like hundreds of times. You've got the little chihuahua barking at you and doing the little things. And then the big dog's like, this is who he is, his nature. This is an aspect of who he is. And this is one of the seven primary faces of God. Each one of these seven areas of society carries one of the aspects of the face of God. We talk about that in our book, Rainbow God, the Seven Colors of Love. And we'll just keep on a little bit more on the creative face of God. Then he made, fishes. You know, do you ever go to an aquarium? It's like, what was he thinking when he was making those? Like, there's fishes, there's a little, making every kind of face look, and they look mean, kind, smiley, frowning, and it's like, and full of colors. It's like, then he got to us finally after he does all this. Humans. And noted, he didn't just say, like, let there be Brad Pitt. I would like there to be 1 billion of these. That's a good looking guy. Or Angelina Jolie, you with it, whatever. You know, there wasn't. He's like, he makes prototypes only as it comes to humans. You look at your face, you looked at your face in the morning in the mirror, there's no other face. There's 7.2 billion people on the planet. Not one face is repeated. They can't even do it with plastic surgery. Nor will there ever be a repeat of that. That's what I'm saying. He's a compulsive creative. So it's that's his essence. And we really haven't re-imaged him properly to the world. See, we're made in his image, and we're called to carry his image into the world. But that's probably the image, the aspect of who he is that we've done the worst with. We've generally presented as a boring God. We're a bunch of copycats. Somebody does something, we all do the same thing. And I guess we're worse than the church, you know. Somebody gets, we're always looking for prototypes and role models, and everybody copies. But yet he makes us all unique. He doesn't even want our fingerprints to be repeated. He's like, no, I don't want them repeated. I don't know if you all heard also. There's no snowflake that's repeated. Like, everyone's different. That's what I'm saying. He's a compulsive creative. So you were made a prototype. So in any way that you're trying to live through somebody else, you get mentored too much, you copy somebody else's life, you're insulting who he made you to be. He wants you to do you. If you don't do you, who's going to do you? So these are all aspects we look at. So these seven areas of society, I don't have time to, again, I'm just throwing out some potpourri stuff. But there's seven faces of who he is, seven aspects of who he is that he's inviting us to look into, to search out, to mine. to seek him as a treasure to be desired and see how he is, to process how he is as communicator. Oh, maybe I'll mention that just a little bit. God is communicator, you know, media. You know there's media in heaven? I believe Gabriel's the head of it there. Don't have time to tell much else here. Anytime there's really good news, it all happens in good news. Heaven operates in good news. Why do we all want to go to heaven? Because we've heard. There are no tears. There is no sadness. There is nothing but good news in heaven. Heaven is also called, have you heard, it's the cloud of witnesses. Now, the cloud of witnesses means what? They can see what's happening here on earth. So, they see more than us all the junk happening on planet earth. But Papa doesn't stop heaven, you know, every day and say, citizens of heaven, I'm just sorry to tell you, we lost 14,622 to hell today. He doesn't do that. He handles that himself. He doesn't expect the citizens of heaven to handle that. He screens media. Everything must happen in the spirit of good news. Paul wrote about that, Philippians 4, 7 and 8. If there be anything good, virtuous, true, positive, noble, if it's that, to go with that. And so there are ways we can incorporate, and I can't tell you more about it, but we really apply this in a very practical way. If you have a call to media, you must understand how media in heaven functions and then bring that truth down on earth, and it'll function better on earth, and there'll be better outcomes. It'll get higher ratings. Because the world is sick and tired of bad news. And the enemy advances his kingdom on the back of bad news. Bad news conditions you to receive more bad news. It's like getting your heart plowed, to receive more bad news. Neither one of us were intended to be able to handle the worst news on the planet of 7.2 billion people every day. But because of modern technology, we have this capability that whoever's being anybody beheaded on planet Earth, 7.2 billion people get to hear about it every day. That never used to happen before. And you were not meant to handle. I wasn't meant to handle the worst of the worst of the worst news on a daily basis. So you want to protect your own heart and spirit. You're actually being ministered to by demonic forces that rule and reign in media when you just allow yourself to be exposed to bad news, bad news, bad news, bad news, and you wonder why you're depressed after a while. So you want to stay encouraged, then you think on those things that are good, positive. How lovely on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news. Only one of them does it say, and proclaim salvation. So good news is spirit that the kingdom of God advances in. So the seven mountains, seven spheres, are seven functions of heaven. They're seven functions of how our Papa operates in heaven. Seven ways he loves. He loves his communicator. He loves his king. He loves his teacher. He loves his provider. He loves his creative one. He loves his Papa. And he loves his redeemer. And we are invited to look at him in the nuance of each one of these. That's why the book Rainbow God, Seven Colors of Love, we identify each one of these seven aspects of God, each one of the seven areas of society, with one of the colors of the rainbow. And that's explained in the book as well. So you get the visual of that. If you think of the God we're supposed to see and manifest in society is not just a one-tone, one-colored God of salvation. That would be the color blue. But we're supposed to see him in his magnificent as the creative one, as the providing one. The creative one would be the color yellow. The God of Papa, God is Papa, the orange color. The God of that's whose communicator, red, etc., etc. And we're supposed to see him and immerse ourselves in who he is and receive personally ourselves, learn to receive his love in all these areas of society, and then manifest it back to society. And that is how darkness gets displaced. And we're entering into a fast-forwarding of that. We're starting to get the revelation of it, and we're starting to awaken to our assignment. So that's what we want to contend for. Now, something about the Seven Mountain message and why I've really appreciated and enjoyed it a lot from a, you know, looking at it from a pastoral perspective. If this were my congregation, if I were a pastor looking at a congregation, statistics tell us that only 3% of our members will ever have a traditional ministry position. It means only 3%. If I look at a church, only 3% will ever in their lifetime be either behind the pulpit, on staff, even whether it's Sunday school or evangelist, whatever it is, all the mission positions you can think about, all the ministerial positions, Only 3% of the people will ever have that. And yet, by and large, that has been the only thing that gets championed. That's the only thing that gets advanced and celebrated from the pulpit. Well, a pastor, a preacher, evangelist will say, get serious with God, and then he may give you a full-time ministry. So you have everybody going after, and quote, a normal full-time ministry. And yet the Seven Mountain message is an invitation to see that he is the God of the other six mountains of society. And it reveals to us that the other 97% are called to function in the other six mountains of society. So most of you are called to function. Your primary, you do have a platform, a pulpit, and a microphone. It's just not inside of a church. It's in a sphere of influence and authority that you have. So that's why we have our resources to help you understand your ministry, your call. There is not one of you that is secular. Every one of you is a full-time minister. It's who you're supposed to be. And it's only if you don't understand that that you live less than you're supposed to. So you want to step into that and be able to fulfill your call and live your Monday through Saturday 9-to-5 schedule. Well, you know, I know the schedule's not as precise as it used to be. But whatever your workplace assignment is from God, we want to understand how you're called to manifest the kingdom's, the king's better ways of doing things in that area of society. You're not called to just lead people to the Lord. You don't even have to. Your assignment is to reproduce who he wants you to look like in that area of society and let the kindness of God lead people to repentance. The goodness and kindness of God lead people to repentance. And so that's part of my message to you, the Seven Mountain understanding of the Seven Mountain mandate, is that all of you are believers and are full-time ministers, and there's an invitation to see them that way. I'm just going to give you a few scriptures that give us the biblical basis for the Seven Mountains, and then I really want to allow Elizabeth to make some connections to our heart and soul there, and then we'll have a ministry time, as there's desire, and see how the Holy Spirit leads on that. But Isaiah 2:2 is a foundational scripture. It says, in the last days, the mountain of the house of the Lord would be exalted on the tops of the mountains. And it says, and all nations will run to it. So that's something that would happen in the latter days that had never happened before. And it doesn't say just that a lot of people will get saved. It is that nations will come to the house of the Lord, that solutions would come out of the household of God, like Joseph provided Pharaoh, so that nations would turn to them. We have seen this manifest. We began to preach and prophesy this about 9 years ago. And since then, we've had the privilege of meeting and speaking and prophesying to prime ministers, presidents, and generals, high-level, top-level government leaders of over 20 nations. And as we've declared that he is the God that provides solutions for them, we've even had invitations and requests to come speak, and they inquire of the Lord for specific things for their nations. And so we've seen him manifest himself as the God of the nations in this kind of way. So he is the God that provides solutions. He wants to manifest. The Seven Mountain mandate, to say it another way, is an understanding that God wants to manifest himself not only as the God of salvation, but the God of salvation, the God who solves problems. That there is no crisis, there is no difficulty, there is no economic crisis, no governmental crisis on planet Earth that he has not already pre-embedded a solution in one of his sons and daughters. That's why the enemy tries to keep you shut down and buy into whatever doctrine, eschatology, that says, no, just wait for Jesus to come do it. Nothing good's happened to the millennium. And while meanwhile, he's saying, arise, shine. He's saying to all of us, Isaiah 60, arise, shine, your light has come. We keep saying, no, your light, you arise, shine. He goes, no, you arise and shine. Your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen on you. I will rise on you as you rise. And it talks about darkness and gross darkness covering the nations and the people. But the Lord will arise on you, and his glory will be seen on you. And nations will walk to the light of the sons of God. Kings, prime ministers, presidents will come to your brightness. That's what we're invited to walk in. So that's what he's still telling us today, is that we are to rise and shine with who he is in society. Fearlessly. The righteous are bold as lions. We don't, you know, every time there's a report of Ebola's coming, the, you know, ISIS is coming, we don't just freeze and hide under our bed and say, Jesus, please rapture us. We arise and shine instead, and allow his presence and glory to be seen on us and we manifest his kindness and goodness and his solutions in every area of society. That same scripture is repeated in Micah 4, so we won't go there. The only specific place in the Bible where it talks about, mentions the terminology seven mountains is Revelation 17:9. You don't have to turn there, you can just list it there. The context of Revelation 17 is a chapter speaking on the devil's system, the demonic system called the harlot or the prostitute, depending on what version of the Bible you have. And it goes in Revelation 17:9, it says, and she lays, the woman lays on seven mountains. Gives us understanding that the enemy has a seven mountain plan for destroying nations. The boardroom of hell is pretty simple. They write on there, steal, kill, destroy. That's what they do. And so they've also figured out that they don't even have to have a plan against people if they have a plan against institutions. Take government, you will cause massive death, difficulty, destruction. If you can take media, if you can take Hollywood, Wall Street, so they have a plan to go after the tops of the mountains. And so we have to be those who understand that's what the enemy is doing. And he often doesn't even have to have his demons assigned to individuals because they just go after the tops. And if he has Christians buying into doctrine or theology or whatever that says, no, we can't do that till the millennium, then we effectively don't rise and shine. We don't fulfill the very first message of Jesus when he said, you are the salt of the earth. And if the salt has lost its savor, it is good for nothing but to be trampled upon. The salt of the earth, for biblical context, for New Testament context, went beyond what we know it as. It wasn't just to make your French fries taste better. The salt of the earth was that which they preserved the meat to keep it from rotting. They didn't have refrigeration. And so you had to cake salt on both sides, and you hang up the meat, and it lasts the longest that it can last. Meat was preserved. So when he says, you are the salt of the earth, he's saying, you are the preserver of your society. And if you don't function as that which preserves your society by carrying my influence, my answers, my anointing, my kingdom, then you will get trampled by the area of society you do not influence. So we keep getting trampled by government, and we go, oh, God, please return Jesus. Government's trampling. We twist the narrative. We think it means he's about to come when things go against us. When Hollywood tramples us, oh my, it must mean that Jesus is about to return. No, it just means we haven't fulfilled our assignment. We've stayed in the salt shaker, and we've had good meetings in the salt shaker, but we didn't get out and manifest the kingdom of God. I'm all for good meetings. We want the salt in the salt shaker as well, but we need the salt to get out of the salt shaker into the seven areas of society, primarily. Proverbs 9:1 says, wisdom has built her house. She has labored on seven pillars, or seven columns, depending on what version of the Bible. Wisdom, the Holy Spirit, the house the Holy Spirit is building on planet Earth is on seven pillars, seven columns, the seven areas, media, economy, government, the seven areas we're talking about. There are seven functions of heaven. Again, they're not just things that exist here. All these areas, just to repeat them, education exists in heaven. Provision still exists in heaven. He doesn't just have 3-billion-year-old antiques there. Creativity is constantly taking place there. There is the family of heaven. There is the honoring of the king that continually takes place, the worship of the king. He's still king there. There's communications. All these systems that exist here on earth exist in heaven, and we are invited to see how they function in heaven and manifest them on earth. And this is a privilege. This will make us wake up different. If you wake up to this reality, it'll change you. People who buy into this, they don't just wake up bored, like, I wonder when Jesus is going to come back. Because you realize you get the privilege of participating with who he is and what he wants to do on planet Earth and seeing the whole Earth filled with the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. That's where it's all headed to. Judges 16:19, story of Samson. Do you remember how Samson lost his strength? How did Samson lose his strength? His hair was cut. You know what it actually says if you read it? It says, then Delilah lulled him to sleep, and she shaved off his seven locks. It's a prophetic parallel word for us. He now had no strength. He just wanted to be raptured. I just added that last bit. But here's the deal. And verse 3, with the seven locks, Samson took the gates of the city. So you get empowered or disempowered by the storyline that you buy into, by your macro narrative. The macro narrative, if you don't believe the kingdom of God is a kingdom sufficiently powerful enough to bring solutions, presence, anointing into every area of society, then you've reduced it's a powerless gospel. This is, in essence, what the church has done. This is what the enemy has done to the church in so many places, has invaded even our seminaries and taught doctrines that limit anything we can possibly do other than we can just get people saved. We can't. The devil's too big for us. We can't mess with him. We have to wait till Jesus comes back again in the millennium. Anything that requires faith is in the millennium somewhere. And so we lose the power, we lose the dunamis, the strength, and we just want to survive or we want him to take us out of here. And so he's inviting us to see him in a different way. We want to get the right script of what's taking place on planet Earth. Again, it starts with perceiving him in a different way. What you think about God is the most important thing about you. You are empowered or disempowered by what you believe about God, about what he's capable of doing, and what his narrative is right now on planet Earth. That's why it's worth shifting and changing. Now, I refer you to Genesis 1, 26 or 28. You know, after the Creator made everyone, there's a moment that says the Godhead got together and said, let us make man in our image. Then he goes on to say, basically, and let them have dominion over everything. Now, you know, he didn't say, let me make man in my image, but let us make man in our image. And if you have an understanding, I think you understand why. Why is the us, let us? It's because the Godhead is a triune being, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us make man in our image. And I'm going to suggest to you, connected to the rest of the message that I've given you, that the Godhead is 1, 3, and 7 as well. And that's not heresy, it's just Bible. In Revelation 4 and Revelation 5, it talks about the seven spirits of God. It said there are seven blazing flames of fire around the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Then says in Revelation chapter 5, it says there are seven eyes of God that are the seven spirits of God, and they run to and fro through the whole earth because they have an assignment here on earth. See, the kingdom must come on earth as it is in heaven. And so, the 1, 3, and 7 parallel picture, and I want to kind of leave it with you as a visual for you to help see. I'm trying to expand to the degree you haven't been exposed to this message. Expand your perspective of him, because if your perspective of him is expanded, then your capacity to carry the kingdom is expanded as well. And to think of him as 1, 3, and 7, and we get this parallel picture of it in a rainbow. And a rainbow is also 1, 3, and 7. Rainbow is white light, and then when water and light have this interaction, it creates this prismic effect where seven colors show up. Of those seven colors, three are primary colors, and they are the colors of fire, and our God is a consuming fire. So the rainbow gives us this perfect picture of who our God is. That's why it was more important than we sometimes understand, is that it was a sign that God gave to Noah, says that I will never destroy mankind again. We say, well, he's not going to destroy him by fire, by flooding, as if that would somehow calm us, you know, like what kind of promise is that? I'm not going to shoot you in the head, but I will stab you. No, it's like that shows our own distortion of the image of God, because he said, despite man's ways being continually prone to evil, I will look at the rainbow, and I will remember my promise not to destroy them. It's because he will reflect on his own capabilities, on his own greatness, on his own love, and the abilities to displace the darkness that exists on planet Earth. And so that's the sign of the rainbow in the heavens. And in Revelation 4 and Revelation 5, it says that there is a rainbow around the throne. It actually comes from the Father, and it circles the throne. So we go to the throne. So when a rainbow shows up on earth, we are seeing something that exists in heaven. And it's a reminder to us that he's greater than whatever challenge exists on planet Earth, and he will manifest himself greater in the end. So that's one of the exciting things about seeing our God in this way. All right. Just laying out a general narrative for the understanding of it. You almost ready to plug into something, Elizabeth, right where I left off? That's good. I'm the warm-up act. You're about to get the really good stuff now. But let me just pray real quick. And then when Elizabeth's done also, we want to see what the Holy Spirit wants to do ministry-wise. But Holy Spirit, we just thank you for being the Spirit of truth, being the counselor, for releasing encouragement to us. We just thank you, Lord, just for how your name was exalted in this place today and how you're here now. And I just, even as I connect to you, just feel your heart. And you're here as a healer tonight as well. And I just speak healing for everyone who needs it, even as this meeting progresses, whether we have a specific time for healing or not. This is a specific time. And I just speak to the bones to be healed and eyes to be healed and cysts to disappear and cancers to disappear and malfunctions of the body to disappear in the name of Jesus and pains to disappear in the name of Jesus. I declare you above every other God, every other false God in this place, every other projection of doctors, every other sentence that comes from the medical industry that anyone is carrying. In the name of Jesus, I speak, Lord, that you are above it. You are the healer. You're the great healer, and I speak your greatness in this place. And I thank you even during this meeting, you're erasing. It just felt like many of you have been fighting depression, oppression, anxiety. And I just declare you're free from that in the name of Jesus. And that you begin to feel just joy inside of you when you even as this meeting progresses to go on. The joy of the Lord is your strength. And never get so religious that you can't enjoy God. So we just release healing in this room. Release joy in this room. Joy and healing. All right, I did something in the microphone. Joy and healing be released in this room. The spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you. Part of that knowledge is you're a healer. You're in a good mood. You love us. You're full of joy. You handle the bad news. And our yoke is easy. Our burden is light because that's the way you want it. We thank you desire to do this great thing on planet Earth with your kids. You're not planning to get rid of us and then do it on your own. You're going to do it with us. The God of peace will crush Satan under our feet. And we thank you that that's your joy to do. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, Elizabeth.
Hey, y'all. Still have some of my southernness left in me. I've decided I'm not going to be able to get rid of it, so I'm going to go with it. I've been here for 2 years, and the first little while I was like, well, I'll just try to kind of fit in. And I just couldn't be me. So hi, y'all. Just love being here with you guys this weekend. It's been really rich, a time here in Fremont at C-Hop this morning and with the Glow Women earlier in the weekend. And so it's just great to be with y'all. And Stephanie, we're just so appreciative and just want to honor you for making this weekend happen. Stand up. Absolutely. Thank you. Y'all just... She obviously was sensing, you know, the heart of the Father to come be in your midst with this specific message. And so we just honor you for being sensitive to his heart and facilitating that. And I know it's a busy time for you with moving and all, and yet you're still about Papa's business. And I love that. I admire it. And just we declare over you grace for all that you're juggling right now. And just everything that you took on to make this happen. So thank you. Yeah. I'm going to pass this around. No obligation at all, but this is an email sign up. Johnny releases prophetic words for the body of Christ for international, national, for this state, and we send those out in email. Some of you prefer not to receive email, and if that's you, I totally get it, but some people prefer email. So I'm just going to pass this around. If you'd like to sign up, you can. Also, we are just about out of all of our resources. There are just like maybe 10 books back there. So on here is the name of our website. You can jot that down if you're wanting to go online and order anything. So I'll just start that over here with you guys, and you can pass it around. And what I would like to do with you, I just want to talk from my heart for a few minutes. And okay, longer than a few minutes, but about, what do we have, 20 minutes? 20 to 30. If you have to leave, you're not going to hurt my feelings. You just do what you need to do. But you'll hurt Johnny's feelings, he says. No. You know, I've been listening to this message, this big picture perspective of what God wants to do in the generations to come and what it looks like for his kingdom, practically speaking, to come to the earth. That's what we're talking about when we talk about the seven mountains. We're talking about a practical format in which we're receiving the heart of God and his better ways of doing everything on earth. And, you know, that's a pretty broad subject. That kind of covers everything. And when Johnny first started preaching about this, of course, I was, we were pastoring the church, our local church together, and he was practicing, preaching this on us there at home. And he was also beginning to travel and speak about it. So I've heard him preach this in several languages and countless nations and, you know, a lot of where we've landed with our language and expression of that is because of just personal conversations and dreaming together. We were married 27 years ago, and when we first were married, our heart's desire was to come together as a team to advance the kingdom, and not really knowing what that looks like and wanting to discover that together. So it's an overflow of our love and our passion for Jesus. And but when he first started preaching about this, I was in a very intense personal time with God, where I was really struggling with some very core trust issues with him. And honestly, I finally got to this place, if you'll allow me to just be this transparent, it wasn't for very long, but I hated God. And that was terribly inconvenient as a pastor to hate God. And fortunately, you know, we were in a season where I knew that was the healthiest thing possible for me, was to just be that raw and broken and honest with myself and with God, who already knew that. And my mom had died of cancer when I was 12, and it was after fighting the cancer for like 5 years, and it was intense. And, you know, probably all of us adults in this room have lived long enough to experience our own level of trauma and pain and the lies that come with that, that our heart, we get so vulnerable and so disappointed that we're, you know, the enemy knows exactly what lies to whisper and plant in our hearts. And it's a process to root those lies out of us. And so I was in the middle of that process with God, of allowing him to root the lies that I had believed about myself and about him because of what I had watched my mom go through. Bottom line, I landed on a really important question that I think every heart, if we get to that place of honesty, we all are asking the same exact question. And it's this: do I really matter? Am I really important? And we're wired instinctively to know that there's only one who can answer that question for us. And it's our Creator, it's our Father, it's the one who dreamed us up. And what we really want to know in all of life is, does he care about us? I think we can get through just about anything if we know that we know that we know. Like if he could appear to you and say to you, I really do love you and care about you. You could get through just about anything because you'd know that nothing happened by random circumstance. You're not just some victim of, you know, hell on earth. And so I'm letting you see very quickly kind of where I'm speaking from. So while Johnny was preaching this profound message of what we're called to do and receive this kingdom on earth, I was wrestling with God in that personal, intimate place. And what God began to show me is that, number one, he really did care, and I really did matter to him. And I'll touch on in just a moment kind of where that question comes from, but first I'll just say this. He began to answer that question for me, and I walked through about a two-year journey where I went through so much inner healing, and some of it was through, you know, tools that our church had in place. We had Sozo and another ministry called Life Skills. But the journey, those were just kind of along the way. The journey was more personal with him. And so what God started speaking to me is he said, the same way that I care for your individual heart, in the same way that I have escorted you through this journey of rooting out those lies that you've believed about me and believed about yourself, in that same way, I care for the collective hearts of cities and nations. And there are lies that have been perpetuated about who you are and who I am through every area of culture. And as the kingdom comes to earth, I am removing those lies from every area of culture about myself. And you've already, that same way that you know that part of my heart, I'm going to demonstrate that on a big picture level. So, for example, those of you that maybe have a passion, you work in the healing rooms. Anybody in here work in the healing rooms? Yeah. Okay, so you are very familiar with that part of God that you know is not okay with us walking around with broken bodies. And there's something in you that contends for the truth about that part of him to be seen and manifest. And in the same way that you can look at something that's broken in someone's body, that same part and heart of God can be applied to the bigger picture. Somebody's back can be out of line, or our economy can be out of line. And so when we have a knowledge of the character of God, it's the same no matter where it's being played out. So what I began to see is this this healing movement that has really been unfolding, and we've been growing in our understanding of it here in our generation. God's been very intentional with that. He wanted us to grow in those in that knowledge of who he is, because that is the bigger picture as well of what he's doing in the earth. Is this making sense? This is so new for me. I'm still learning how to give it language, how to express it. So I want to just look at a scripture real quick that's going to help us understand that better. If you'll open up Mark 12, verse 29. Mark 12, verse 29. Before I jump into that, I just want to say a couple more quick things. I can't remember which time this weekend you shared this, but Johnny spoke about how God is the perfect father, And he, like a perfect parent, knows how to go after those things in our hearts and our lives that aren't reflective of his true heart. And he's on this journey with each one of us to bring us to this place of freedom, freedom from the lies that have been sown into our hearts, from the pain that we've been through. He's on the same journey with us as humanity collectively. So we understand, obviously, God can relate to each one of us in a very individual, personal way. But God's heart is also, and we're made in his image, so we kind of understand this. God's heart is also, he calls Israel his firstborn among many nations. So there's something in the heart of God that can relate to an entire city and nation, a people group, in a very intimate way. There's a collective heart of regions and cities and nations, of people groups. And there's something about our God that relates to us in both dynamics. And as the perfect parent, he is growing us up, not just individually, but collectively. And we see this when you look at different issues going on. I know we have a 14-year-old, and I have a few issues that I'm working with her on. And it's a struggle sometimes to not just pile it on, because I'm not the perfect parent, I've discovered a long time ago. But I've learned by the way that God has parented me that he doesn't go after all my issues at one time. Thank you, God. And same thing with us collectively as society. And you can look and see, even through Scripture, how if you were to look at the God of the Old Testament that they wrote about, it was almost like a two-year-old writing about their parent. You can imagine if you have a two-year-old that's going to describe to you what their daddy's like. Well, he says no, no, no all the time. And he won't let me do this, and he won't let me do that, and I have to do these things every single day. And God was going after very specific things in them. But he wasn't going after things that today, many generations later, we would never have tolerated, right? A church leader having more than one wife, slavery, women not having an equal voice. As society, he's been growing us up into his ways. And we see this, and the importance of seeing it and understanding it now is that we need to align our perspective with his perspective. And I think there's a danger in our generation right now of in the house of God of us kind of panicking over the things that we're realizing are really not healthy in ourselves, but especially in the world. And we are so afraid of appearing to condone sin. And so I think it's really important to understand we're on a journey with God, the same way that he's dealing with us individually. We're growing personally in God's ways, the knowledge of God, his better way of doing things in our own lives. Then that gives us a better perspective of how the same God deals with us as a collective society and cities and nations. So when we realize what he's been unfolding in our individual lives, he's been unfolding this understanding of getting free from these lies. He's been bringing us into these deeper, more raw, honest places of worship where we can just lay ourselves out before him in a transparent way and speak directly to him. Just one generation ago, they didn't worship like that. You see how he's been bringing us to greater and greater measures of freedom and understanding his love. We're finally beginning to understand, you know, this whole grace message that's out right now. And people are kind of, they're a little scared of it, but we're also drawn to it. Could he really love us unconditionally? But yet we want to make sure that it doesn't mean we're giving license to sin. And it's with each generation, we're learning and multiple things are being restored to us. The cool thing I think about that, one cool thing about that is that it is becoming more obvious that there's not this big, huge line. And just let me say this all the way through before you judge it. There's not this huge demarcation between us and them. And the enemy has wanted it that way. And I think we're beginning to understand that he's given us permission to erase that line. Okay? There are sons and daughters of God all over this planet. It's just that some of them don't yet know they're his. And they have, like we have, a free will to choose if they're going to acknowledge that they are his and receive what Jesus gave us that restored us to our Father. When we really get that, then that line gets erased and we realize that God has given us permission to just simply love the way we've been discovering he simply loves and adores us. We cannot give away what we don't have. And God is giving us a lot right now. If you just kind of take inventory on our short lifetimes, what's been being restored back to the body of Christ, things that we're growing in. Generations before us, it was things like, you can only have one wife, and slavery is not okay, and etc. I think one of the next big things that he is unfolding to us, sorry, our daughter's calling, is this understanding of the kingdom and what it looks like for the kingdom to come, his better ways of doing everything. We really are going to get to the scripture, but I'm just little rabbit trails, and then I'll just pull into a stop and we'll be done. But when I think about the kingdom, I'm beginning to understand it's not just some ethereal concept or idea. So I like to think of it this way. Evidently, when there used to be kingdoms, okay, there wasn't technology like there is today. And kingdoms, you could be a citizen of a kingdom and not have ever really personally met or known your king, whose kingdom you are a part of. But you knew the heart of your king based on the culture of the kingdom that you lived in. And you knew the heart of the king based on what kind of culture he provided. Did you feel safe? Did you have your basic needs met? Was there an atmosphere of celebration? Was there an opportunity to grow and to flourish and to excel and be successful, etc.? So this kingdom is not all that different from that idea. There is a king whose heart has not been correctly manifested in the earth yet. And when I think of the scripture Johnny referred to, Habakkuk 2:14, the knowledge of the glory of God will cover the earth as the water covers the sea. Moses asked to see the glory of God. And what passed before him? The goodness of God. It says God hit him in the rock and he showed him his goodness and he proclaimed his name before him. His glory is simply his goodness. It's all the kajillion ways that he's good and only good. The correct reputation of our God was stolen from us in the garden. When we collectively, through Adam and Eve, because any of us would have made the same decision, and God knew that. God was not surprised when they did the one thing he told them not to and ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And God knew that he wanted intimacy with us so badly. That he knew there were certain ingredients that have to be present in order for intimacy to be there. Number one, free will. We get that. You have to choose or it's not really love. You know, if the deck is stacked and it's just a no-brainer, of course we're going to love him. We have to love him. We can't help but love him. Is that truly intimacy that's going to fulfill the heart of God? No. So he gave us free will. He also, you know, in order to have intimacy, you have to have trust. And in order to have intimacy, you have to have mutual trust, which means mutual vulnerability. We're pretty vulnerable. God had to choose to make himself vulnerable, and he made himself vulnerable by allowing the possibility of us to doubt him to exist. So when we ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, from that time forward, something in all of our brains, we inherited from Adam and Eve and all the way through the generation, something in our brains awakened that had not previously been awakened. And it was the ability to look at something or someone and think, good or evil? And so, of course, immediately the question for Adam and Eve was, is God's heart towards me good or not? They felt shame. They covered themselves because they felt shame. They doubted the character of God, and the reputation of our God became tainted. The enemy, we were born, every one of us was born into a war zone. If you haven't noticed already, we were born into a war zone, and this war zone is against an enemy who loathes and hates our Father more than we can really comprehend. Ultimately, it's not even us that he's after. And yet, there's no comparison between this enemy and our God. No comparison. He has no power of his own. He doesn't exist apart from God allowing to him to exist. But this enemy cannot touch God, so he goes after the object of God's affection, the desire of God's heart, the ones God created for intimacy with himself. This is the war zone you were born into. And so he he's the perfect father. And how could you hurt the perfect father? If the perfect father were separated somehow from their child, can you imagine, those of you that are parents, you get a feeling of this. If you loved your child with a perfect love, but that child was not able to experience or to understand how much they were truly loved by that father, how hurtful that would be to that father's heart, who loves perfectly. I don't think there's anything more tragic than a love that is given but not received. So from that point forward, as sin has played out in the earth, we talked about these lies that we personally, you know, are up against in our personal hearts and lives that come because of the pain that we go through, and the pain communicates to us, he really doesn't care. He's not intentional. If he even exists, you're on your own. And that's the common lie. So in the same way, these, like the kingdom that we talked about, this culture, these areas of culture have been established by people that have varying degrees of understanding of the true heart of God. So when you don't believe that God exists, or you believe he exists, but he's not, like, he doesn't really care about us, then we have different variations of an orphan mentality. And so with our orphan mentalities throughout the generations, we have put into place systems in each area of culture that reflect our belief about this perfect father. And most of our understanding of his heart has been significantly wrong, significantly off. So culture itself becomes a litmus test of the knowledge of God on earth. I'm going to give you some real specific examples here in just a second, and then we'll close it up. My phone is my clock, so I'll take it back. Yeah. And let me just go ahead and go into the scripture. Mark 12:29. So this guy is asking Jesus a question, and the Pharisees, this is not my typical translation, so it's reading a little different than I'm used to, but from what I can remember from my other translation, is this a Pharisee, and he's asking Jesus a question, and they're trying to catch Jesus, okay? They don't understand that he is the God of the universe standing right there before him. So they're asking the God of the universe a question. So he says, verse 28, one of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, of all the commandments, which is the most important? So he's asking God, who wrote the Ten Commandments, which, you know, he's trying to catch him. How well do you know Scripture? Which I think is really funny. So Jesus answers. He's so gracious. Oh, he's so kind. He says, the most important one, first of all, that he would even answer, right? The most important one is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Then, just to kind of be playful, I believe, with him, he says, I can tell you the second one too. I don't just know the first one, I can tell you the second one. The second one is, love your neighbor as yourself. There's no commandment greater than these. So he passed the test with flying colors that this Pharisee was asking him. So I believe that the Pharisee, from where I read it before in the context that I had read it in the other translation, that his heart was not as evil as it might be sounding. And I think I just imagine him one day with Jesus in heaven, and Jesus was gracious with him now because he knew he was going to be really embarrassed once he saw him for real. He says, well said, teacher. Congratulations, you passed the test. You are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. So the question they're asking and the answer they both agree on is that love is the most important thing of all. But he too goes a step further and he says, in fact, those commandments are so important that they're more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. That doesn't mean a whole lot to us right now, but the equivalent of it would almost be saying, what's more important, love is more important than even how we deal with sin. That was how they dealt with sin, was through offerings and sacrifices. Now, in no way am I trying to belittle what Jesus did for us, because Jesus dealt with sin once and for all for us. And when we acknowledge who he is and make him Lord of our life, then we are applying that once and for all to our own lives. But I love Jesus' response. He says in verse 34, when Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, you're not far from the kingdom of God. So the kingdom of God, I believe, especially in our generation, this is a truth that we're about to really own, and that as the perfect parent, our God is growing us up into right now. And we get to align ourselves with the issue of our hearts that he's going after collectively. And that is this: our perspective on our role in the earth. I believe it's so simple. And it's as simple as what he manifests to us. He has shown us and convinced us of his incredible love for us. And what we have, we can give away. what we have, we can give extravagantly and radically away. And when we do, it's nothing less than the kingdom coming to earth. Sin and behavior is important only and only because we are important. Behavior is important only because we are important. And when we become convinced of that for ourselves, I think you've all been on enough of a journey with God to understand what I'm saying for yourself. Like, he really loves you. That's why he goes after those areas that he wants you to grow up and deal with character issues. It's not because he's ever trying to shame us. It's not because he's a Buddha sitting that we need to put our oranges before. It's not like, I'm holy and I need more holiness. Bring me your holiness. I demand holiness. That's not the case. He is desiring to be so intimate with us that he dealt with everything that would prevent us from being as close and intimate with him as possible. The sunshine, a ball of fire, is not something that, how do I say this? If God was the sunshine and I wanted to be near him, I'd have to become fire to survive him so that I could be near him. Doesn't make him mean, doesn't make him demanding. It just, he is what he is, and he is holiness. And so anything that is not holy is consumed by him when it's near him. So he remedied that. He put a fire suit on me so I could cozy up next to the sun. So that I wouldn't be consumed by him. Jesus is our fire suit so that we can cozy up to our God, to our Father. And to the degree that we get that, we can give it away to the world. And that line that the enemy wants to put between us and those who don't yet know that they're his, God is dealing with that. And he's giving us permission to just love. And as we do that, we're bringing his better way of doing everything into every area of culture. And I'll close with this. This is in the Rainbow God book. But in the Rainbow God book, we talk about how the last chapter is, what does love look like coming out of you? So when we talk about Rainbow God, the book is called Rainbow God, the Seven Colors of Love. We're talking about the simplicity of who God is. He is love. In his essence and his core, who we've all looked and tried to figure out who he is, it all whittles down to that one simple but profound thing. He is love itself. And so ultimately, a kingdom that reflects this king is going to be an expression of love. And it's going to be what love looks like, what God looks like coming through every area of culture. I believe in the end, there will be, I don't know that it will be, you know, utopia on earth, but I believe there will be a strong example in every area of culture of the expression of God as love through that area of culture. We will be able to interact. I don't know if we'll see it fully in our lifetimes, but I believe there will be a generation that will interact with a government that causes them to feel so cared for and so loved by God. They'll be able to interact with an education system that expresses what God as love looks like coming through that teacher, wise heart of God. Every area of culture. And so those lies that are being perpetuated about our God are going to be dealt with. And those questions in our hearts that resulted, you know, does he care about me or does he not, from that original Garden of Eden apple pie experience. They're going to be answered in the hearts of a generation, even by the way that they experience culture. We're at a very interesting time as a generation because we're being invited by God to begin to dream, what does it look like for him to show up in culture and to believe for what there isn't a whole lot of example of right now. And to believe that God, first of all, that he cares enough that he wants to show up in every area of culture, that he wants to heal those broken places. And you're already experts. I'm going to just speak to the older ones in our room right now, in our generation. You are already experts on that part of the character of God. You believed and contended for the more. You saw just a glimpse of his goodness and you took it really far. You're going to take it even farther. But in our short lifetimes, I think about when my mom was sick and it was so rare back then. You were one of those kind of crazy people if you believed God still healed. I remember it was kind of crazy that she even spoke in tongues, you know, like that was, but it's so much more common now. And so there's a muscle in the spirit realm that you've already exercised, pulling that part of the heart of God, that character, that restoring that part of his reputation to the earth. And you can't stop there. Because that same part of him that you've seen show up in individual hearts and lives wants to show up in the collective hearts of cities and nations through every area of culture. And that muscle that you are accustomed to activating can be used to pull down and draw into this realm that next part of the character and heart of God that we're contending for. We can leverage what was stolen from us in the garden. We can leverage the reality that took place when we ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The enemy already does it, right? So when we go through circumstances, our hearts are already prone to question God. You see atheists who supposedly don't believe there's a God. Who do they get angry with when things go horribly wrong? Okay, even those of us on the other side who have known God all of our lives, you get a good parking place and you feel just a little more loved and seen by God. But we can leverage that as we begin to pull on this character and heart of our God who cares enough to bring solutions, to give us supernatural solutions for every problem that exists, even though we don't deserve it. We can pull on that part of his heart and leverage it and begin to take advantage of the fact that people experience circumstances and they attribute it, at least on a subconscious level, to what God really thinks and feels about them. Currently, there's so much, you know, corruption and wrong use of power in government that we've believed collectively this lie about God. I just wish I had time to go into all the lies, and I don't. But what I want to encourage you in is to continue to use that muscle in the spirit that you already have and to leverage it and to call it down and to manifest it and encourage it in your kids and encourage it in your grandkids. We can even look at those sons and daughters of God that are in every area of culture that don't yet know they're his. And you can love so radically and be so free of this concern that we're going to look like we're condoning sin or a lifestyle of sin. You can look at those that have already begun accessing God's solutions. Some of them have accessed more solutions than we have. They just don't know they got it from the heart of God. But that's how humble he is, and that's how generous he is. He is already bringing his solutions and offering them in the earth. Everywhere you see evidence of something that looks even close to God's heart for the earth, it was sourced in him. And so we can begin to celebrate those things and have those things in common with those other sons and daughters of God and say, you know that thing in you that's just so wants to see justice done in this area of culture? Well, that's him. That's his heart. I had the best time a few weeks ago. I'll close with this example. I became a Greenpeace person. I don't even know what you call it. Is it Greenpeace that I joined? What's that, Greenpeace? My subscription ran out, and I probably won't renew it. But anyway, we were walking through a mall, and I just saw this young man who was so passionate about, what's it called, the earth? The environment, that's the word, the environment. And I stood, and I just listened to his spiel. He was, you know, giving a spiel to whoever would listen, and he was talking about an animal that was going extinct and about, you know, I saw Jesus in his face. And I saw the heart of my God who cares about this earth that he created. And I saw that this young man, though he most likely, I'm fairly certain, he did not know God, he knew a part of God that I didn't have a clue about. And I was able to tell him. And I was able to celebrate it and say, You're not going to believe this, but I'm a Christian. I just want to tell you I'm so sorry for any Christian you've ever heard of or met that says they know God, but we haven't known this part of God that you know. And I want you to know that you really do know God. And you have an intimacy with him that is so attractive to me. Like, I'm going to sign up for whatever you want me to sign up for right now, because I love God and I see him in you right now. I'm hearing his heart in you. And I saw something in his entrance to God began to be healed. There are men that started off in government with a heart to serve that don't even know that that was a part of God's heart, that they were made to display. And it got corrupted along the way. And we have the privilege of throwing aside the false battle lines that the enemy has drawn us to. He has wasted so much of our energy saying, oh, you got to hurry up and convince them of how wrong they are in this area and how distorted they are in this area. And you got to make sure that, you know, America stays like it is or goes back to where it was. And I hope I'm not stepping on toes, but they're all false battlefronts. We are an army of lovers. And we were created to love ruthlessly, fearlessly, extravagantly, radically, and to call out the treasure that is hidden in the dirt. And his treasure is in these sons and daughters of God who all have varying degrees of an orphan mentality like us. We're all on a journey of being healed of that core question. We know he exists. We're just not sure what he thinks about us. And they're not sure either. And to the degree that you have grown enough in the knowledge of God, you can take that and give it away extravagantly. When they experience love like we've experienced, only then will they be able to experience the freedom of true conviction that leads to repentance and not shame, that leads to a wall crashing down between them and their daddy. And so what you've grown in, and in our generation as sons and daughters of God, as believers, as Christians, what we've grown in, We are invited to begin to display in all the ways that are available in every area of culture, in every color, what God as love looks like.
Very good. If you'll just stand, we know we've kept you a long time sharing things, but hopefully it's ministered to your hearts and spirits, expanded your perspectives of Him. You know, there are problems in the world, but back to the Philippians 4 passage, if there be anything good, noteworthy, positive, I could lay out like the 10 top markers of society right now and convince you, I won't do it, don't have enough time, but we're actually in the best days ever. And, you know, there's 250,000 people a day coming to the Lord. 2.4 billion followers of Jesus Christ. One of every three on the planet says, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. 35,000 a day coming to the Lord in China. Over 25,000 Muslims getting saved every day. There are over 700 million people filled with the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit filled believers on planet Earth. 100 years ago, a little over 100 years, there was not even 0.0001%. And now it's one in every 10 people on the planet are filled with the Holy Spirit. There's never been a day like this in history. The kingdom of God is forcefully advancing right now. Of those, 160 million of them are Catholic charismatics. There's a massive move of the Holy Spirit among Catholics right now. And even things like abortion, 1990 CDC numbers, 1.4 million a year. 1.4 million abortions a year. Last year, there were 800,000. It's the lowest number since the year before Roe versus Wade. Have to think about that for a while. Teen pregnancies are the lowest since 1940. Probably surprised a lot of people. The lowest since they've ever been looking at them. Ever since they started having statistics. World extreme poverty was at 50% in 1980. It's at 20%, as of 2012. Dropped from 50% in 1980 to 20% in 2012. That's the lowest it's ever been in history. So, those are that's a lot of good news. Yeah, do we have brokenness, mental anguish, families? Yeah, there's problems. But the kingdom of God is forcefully advancing. And it's only going to continue in that way. Of the increase of His government, His kingdom, there will be no end. So I just wanted you to carry that spirit of good news. But I just want to give a chance to the Holy Spirit to come and minister to anybody right now that would need it. And so if you just hold your hands up like this. And Holy Spirit, I just ask that Your presence would come on everyone that's here. In fact, I just believe right now He wants to confirm some of you that have. A lot of you are already praying for the sick, and you have a unique calling there, and you may not need this. But I believe the Lord wants to confirm, the Holy Spirit wants to confirm to you personally, some of you right now, that He has a call for you, a unique call in praying for the sick, that you yourself are called to carry healing in your hands. So I'm going to ask you to just lift up both your hands a little higher right now. And this is a sign not from me, but from the Holy Spirit to you. Just keep your eyes closed, lift your hands, and this will be the sign. When I ask the Holy Spirit to confirm it to you in your right arm, you'll feel like numbness go through it. It'll either feel like a wind or numbness, or it will start vibrating. And that'll be a sign from the Holy Spirit to you saying, you're carrying my healing. You're carrying my healing power. Pray for people. Even if the first 10 don't get healed, keep praying for people. So Holy Spirit, I ask even right now that You would confirm in this room those that are called to carry Your healing. You're the healer of society. You're the healer of bodies. And I ask that You would confirm that in these that are here right now by releasing that confirmation even in their right hand, right arm, in the name of Jesus. Let that come now. Okay. Yeah. Increase. Increase. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. All right, you can put your hands down for a moment. Look at me. I saw that confirmation on several of you. But how many of you either felt it, either your hand just started vibrating or you felt it like go numb? Just raise your hand and just wave it at me if that was you. Yeah, okay. About 25 of you. Yeah. So he's here to heal. Now, how many of you right now need to be healed of something in your body? Raise your right hand and go like this. Okay. Just keep that hand up a little bit like this, not so hard that it hurts you. Holy Spirit, I ask that right now that your presence, your healing presence, would be made known, that your dunamis power would be released into this room. Now, raise if you need that healing again, raise that one hand again. If you're around them and you're one of those that got that confirmation, either you already knew it or you got the confirmation that you're one of the healers, just put your hand on that person's shoulder, on their arm in some way. Just let's gather around each other. So, again, if you have that confirmation that you're called to heal, don't just stand right there. Now, go to somebody who has their right hand lifted up, put your hand on their shoulder, and just say, be healed in the name of Jesus. Lord, let your healing power come in right now. Let your healing power come in right now. All right, the people around, so some people still don't have anybody around, so just touch them. Somebody, make sure everybody who has their hand up has a hand on them. I don't know if you want to. Yeah, even if you don't have a special gift or special confirmation, all of us can pray for the sick and see the healing power of God. So, Lord, let your power just come through this room even now. I release the power of God in this room. Dunamis power. Every pain, bend and bow in the name of Jesus. Yeah, it's coming with joy in places. Pain, bend and bow in the name of Jesus. Joints that didn't operate correctly begin to operate correctly in the name of Jesus. Pain in the knees go away in the name of Jesus. In the shoulders, in the ankles, stomach ailments and problems. Be healed, be restored now in the name of Jesus. More, let it increase in this room. It's coming with joy as well. Because a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. So just release that, Lord. Release the joyous healing in this place. Release the joyous healing, the joy. Yeah, some that's how you're receiving it. It's coming to you as joy and you're being healed. More, Lord. More, Lord. I just speak to bones to receive the kingdom of God. Blood work, be restored in the name of Jesus. Let the power of the blood of Jesus be released in this room even right now. And let their healing, that healing come around. Anxiety, depression, oppression, again, be gone in the name of Jesus. Be lifted off in the name of Jesus. Let your power come in here, Lord. Just keep. All right. Pain go away. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. In that, just Elizabeth's going to read something over us, just the Father's heart over us. And whether you're raising your, you know, if your hand gets tired of being raised, you can put it down. We don't want you to have to do that. But there's something. How many felt like pain go away? Just raise, you know, you were prayed for and the pain went. I know sometimes some of the healing is not just pain, but just raise your, move your hand like this. Okay, there's a few of those. Thank you, Lord. How many felt some heat come into their body? You felt some presence come into your body. Just move your hand like that. Okay, some other ones. Yeah, okay. but just, you know, he is so not a God of religion. He's a God of presence. And this is just a couple of minutes of just, if you'll close your eyes again and just receive, just impartation. I just feel like the Lord, I've seen like I can look at you in the spirit and see there's some of you are on fire. You're carrying a strong river stream of the Lord. Otherwise, you're a little bit dried up. Like you're needing a little presence. You're needing to be like rained on. And so I just believe his rain is here right now, like in the spirit. If you could see what's taking place in this room, there's just a rain. Some of you are feeling it like a mist. And so if you just hold your arm, just however you, whatever posture you do to receive, I mean, if it's hold your hands like this, just something. Don't cross your arms like this because it's hard to receive crossing your arms. And just something to receive. And Holy Spirit, just let your presence, your encouragement, come on your sons and your daughters right now in this room. I release the encouragement of Papa God on you in the name of Jesus. While she's reading, I'm just going to walk around, just touch different ones of you, but you just keep receiving from him.
Sometimes, because of that question in the core that we were talking about, is, God, what do you really think of me? Because that question isn't sufficiently answered in our core, our body manifests weakness. And so I just want to read over you again the heart of God towards you that would heal those places, those wounds that would allow physical things to fester in our bodies. And we just hear you saying tonight, Father, you're my sons and my daughters. I love you. You belong to me, and what delight I have that you're mine. What delight you give me when you know that you're mine. You're hidden in me, and nothing can take you from my hand. Nothing can divert my gaze from being on you. It always has been and always will be. You are always in my sight. I'm yours. I'm in you. I hold you together in the very structure of who you are. I hold you and I surround you. You have access to all of who I am from close, from within you. I'm behind every breath and every beat of your heart. I know you in ways you can't even imagine or understand. I know everything about you, what makes you, you. I know your every thought, word, choice, and action. And I know you so well that I know what you'll do and the choices you'll make before you even make them. Because I know how you're made and what you've been through and how you've processed things. And you don't overwhelm me. I am never discouraged when I think of you. I know you and I love you. And I'm easily able to enjoy you like you are right now. You're the one that I've chosen before I set time into motion. I chose you to live now. I chose you to come alive to the reality of who I am in this time in history. I chose you because I wanted you to know me like I know you. And I wanted you to discover in a way that you'll know for all of eternity that I value you. I wanted you to discover that I want you. You matter. You have significance because I made you and because you're my son and my daughter. I want you near me with nothing between us. Jesus, his perfection was enough to tear down anything that would ever keep us apart. And because of your great value to me, I sent my very best just for you. Before time, I created you perfect and blameless enough to fill my heart with joy forever. And what was stolen from you and from us has been restored. I look at you and I see you as I made you, perfect. You don't disappoint me. You thrill my heart with one look my way. And I am for you. I was for you before you were born. I was for you in the midst of the lies of your circumstances and tragedies and crisis. I was for you in your worst moment so far. I was for you yesterday, and I will be for you tomorrow. I will be for you every moment you have yet to experience. I'm already there waiting for you, waiting to show you who I am and how much I care. But you must look for me. I will be the one for you. I'll be the one with the answers you're looking for, the peace you're craving, the love you're needing. I'll be the one cheering for you. I'll be the one speaking life to sustain you and comfort you. I will be the voice of truth. So listen for me. I'll be the proud papa waiting for you to come home to, always ready to process with, the one with the satisfied look on my face, full of pride in who you are, because you're mine. I tell you now, and every day if you'll hear me, you are of immeasurable worth to me. You have value beyond your comprehension, and anything that tells you otherwise is a lie from our enemy. You matter. I have given you important things to say and important things to do because you are important. So say them and do them boldly and in confidence as one who is valued, loved, and important because you are. Do them with me and through me, because all I've ever really wanted was to be close to you and us know each other face to face. In me, you can do anything. You can get through anything. You can be as important as I created you to be. I value you so much that I want you to represent me. Show them who you know me to be. You can know me, and you already do more than you think you do. You've seen me, you've known me, and you can know me in an ever-increasing way. Discover me and look for me and care about what I care about. Know me and know that I love you. No one could love you more than I do right now. So God, we open every cell of our bodies, every corner of our heart, to let that truth, that love, hit its mark in us right now. And we tell every cell in our bodies to line up with that truth. Every cell right now, just drink in the light, the life, the love of our God. We receive, though we cannot understand or comprehend, we receive the fullness of who you are right now. Every bit of the strength of who you are that makes up for every weakness that is in our bodies, that is in our mind, our hearts, our soul. We just feast on your goodness, oh God. And we allow it to nourish us right now, to change and correct and address deficiencies in our bodies, to heal our perspectives of ourselves and of you and of our brothers and sisters that are looking desperately for you. Oh, we love you, God. Oh, how we love you. We receive your love right now. We live to know you. We live to make you known. We live to learn to be loved, simply loved by you. Thank you that you're teaching us how to be loved by you, and you're teaching us how to give that love away. God, I just declare your timing over every person in this room. God, I thank you that you had something specific in mind when you created each one, and each one has a purpose and a destiny to fulfill and to walk in. And I declare that no plan of the enemy will prosper over you until you have fully completed the destiny and the purpose that was dreamed up in the heart of our God for you. And God, until that time, I ask that you would bolster them in your freedom, that you would free us from the fear of the enemy, that we would live fearlessly and boldly in this love.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. He loves you. Well, Ron, we're done. It was so good hanging with you all. May new dreams from heaven invade your life even tonight. May your dream life be activated to a whole new level of dreaming with Papa. Thank you.